Well, welcome. We want to thank you for worshiping with us here at Resurrection today. My name is Blake Thomas. I'm one of the Connection and Care pastors here at Resurrection.
And I'm Ashley Morgan Kirk. I'm our online community pastor.
It's our hope that every time you worship with us, whether it's in person or online, that you can take steps to deepen your faith and your commitment to this Christian community. And one way you can do that is by letting us know you are here and how you are worshiping. And you can go to core.org/next, click tell us you're here. You can do that on your phone, on your iPad, computer, whatever it is, but we would just love to know you're here. And while you're doing that, Ashley has a few other things that we're going to talk about today.
I would love to share with you some things that are coming up in the life of the church. So the first thing is that each year we commission new volunteers that serve in the care area, and they are called Connection and Care Ministers. And often you will hear us shorten this to CCM. So these are people who every week they are praying over all of our prayer requests in person and online. They are extending themselves in support and care if so desired. And they are working with our pastors to be able to provide the best care that we can as a church. It's a beautiful process. Yeah. And we are blessed to have so many of them. And we're honoring them this weekend, celebrating them and commissioning them. So I want to share with you, not everybody knows that every location of Resurrection in Kansas City and online has a team of CCMs. And these CCMs do the care. They do the work of the care, and they work with pastors. So I want to name for you just some of our online CCMs, a few of them that we're commissioning together today, and others that are on our team, and we're just celebrating them. So we have a team online of 14 online volunteers.
That's great. That's a lot of people to commission this weekend.
I know. And there are a few of them that have been serving with us, whether they just started in the last few months or whether they've been serving with us for about a year, and we are commissioning them today. So I want to particularly name Diane A, Betsy H, Susan L, Denise M, and Betsy V. So they are the ones that are newer to our online team. And we bless them today as they walk in and step into ministry in this way. And then there are others who are already serving on our team, on the online team specifically. So Judah Beth B, Barb C, Kathy C, Brian D, Mary H, Betsy H, Barbara J, Timothy M, Denise M, Marilyn S, and Carol S.
I wish we could have a cake or something to celebrate with
that. I know, I know. Perhaps you have a cake that you can celebrate them with. But I just want you to know, this is an amazing volunteer role. If that is ever of interest to you in exploring what that volunteer role looks like, go to core.org/care this weekend and just express some interest in that. And we'd be happy to share with you what the requirements are of that, what the application and interview looks like, and walk with you to see if this is a way that you'd love to serve your community, your church community.
That's great. We're so grateful for our CCMs. I get to work with our CCMs every single week, and they're such a resource and such a valuable thing here at Resurrection. We're so blessed by them. Kind of going on that theme, where we're celebrating all things care this weekend in worship and in Resurrection. And there's so much to care that happens at Resurrection, which really makes us unique, I think.
I agree.
There's so much. It's so cool. You can connect with a pastor at any time or online. But then we have all these support groups and additional resources that are provided here. And we just want to highlight a few of them for you today. The first is our recovery ministry. And this is specific a ministry that offers support and assistance to those affected by various forms of addiction. And we have a whole list of classes that meet both in person at our Leadwood location and a few of our other locations, as well as online. So whether you can join us in person or whether online feels more comfortable, we hope you will check that out. Everything from AA to Al-Anon to Nar-Anon and many others. So we hope you will check out all those listings available at core.org/next. And it's just an incredible type of thing that we are so blessed to offer here at Resurrection. Another thing we're really grateful to offer is support groups. And these take on a very many different forms. We have those who are going through maybe grief or recent loss. We have support groups for that. We have those that might be going through difficult diagnoses, whether that's health-related or mental health, physical health. We have cancer support groups and many others here at Resurrection. We also have divorce support groups, as well as a job search support group, because that can be a tough process at times. So there's lots of different support groups here at Resurrection, and we just hope that you will check them out as well at core.org/next. And the last thing, kind of what Ashley already mentioned, is we have these incredible congregational care ministers, or CCMs, and pastors that just want to lift people up in prayer. So every week when you submit your attendance, you can also submit a prayer request. And you can choose whether to have someone reach out to you directly, or just to, you know, stay anonymous if you want to. But that's just our way to just lift you up in prayer and connection. And that's one of our biggest hopes here. And our CCMs pray for those every single week. And if you were ever wanting to connect with a pastor or a CCM, we would love to know whether that's in person or online, just to get you connected with that and to provide you the best care possible. So again, you can find all those details at core.org/next. We would just love to partner alongside you and offer care however we can.
What's amazing about those support groups, so we are highlighting, you know, CCMs, those support groups are also, many of them, led by volunteers. So they have an amazing role that they're able to help. And many of them have walked through that themselves. And so they know what it feels like. It just feels great to know that you're not alone. And they know how important that is. So that drives their desire to serve in this way. The other thing that's really cool about this, now, I know both of us have CCM teams. Yours at Leewood and, and mine online. And we pray together when some of us meet to do some of the logistical work of prayer requests. We will pray together, and I want to just share with you what we pray. We will pray that our CCMs are equipped with God's Spirit, that they are able to remind those who have reached out in care of God's presence that is with them, and that we understand all of those prayer requests represent a desire to have God care for us directly. And we believe that God does, and also that God cares for us through people. And so that's a part of our prayer as well. We pray that every week together. And I know that your team also has a really cool rhythm that they do as well as they pray over things. So anyway, I just think it's really awesome. And we're big cheerleaders of it. Yes. We want you to know about all of those resources that you have. Okay. So one more thing. We have summer student serve trips. I'm impressed that I was able to say
that. That was pretty good, yeah.
Summer student serve trips that are coming up. And if you have a student in your life, we want to remind you that you can get 10% off if you sign up before March 1. And so we have those coming up. They are coming up in a lot of different places this summer. So Little Rock, Arkansas, Asheville, North Carolina, and then even here in Kansas City. So for all the dates and the details and to sign up, visit core.org/next.
I know, Ashley, both you and I have been on student ministry trips, and they are so much fun and just such a blast. And it's so incredible to see students go through that process and to see just their hearts opened. And if you are someone that's interested in volunteering as well, I'm sure they would work that out. And if you're interested, check that out. And just such a rewarding experience for students and families.
It's true. You learn that faith is a verb on mission trips. If you didn't already know that, that's the core takeaway. Well, all of this to say, we're ready to head into worship. So like Blake was saying, as we head in, we know that we're expecting to encounter God. So let's open our hearts, our minds, and our spirits to encounter God together in worship.
Hello, welcome to Resurrection. Will you join us as together we sing? Will you stand? Sing, I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade were never enough. And you came along, and you put me back together. Satisfied here in your love. Let's sing it together in one voice. There's nothing. See, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Now I'm not afraid to show you
My name is Adam Hamilton. I'm the senior pastor here at Church of the Resurrection, and we are so excited you're joining us for worship today. It is going to be an awesome service. I want to invite you to do several things as you prepare for worship. One is, if you have access to a candle, go ahead and get it out and light it. That's a reminder that God is in your midst, and wherever you are, that is your sanctuary. I'd like to encourage you to have pen and paper handy. Somewhere during this service, God is going to speak to you. I really believe that. In song, scripture, prayer, or sermon, you're going to hear God speaking to you. Write down what you hear and what you want to remember and reflect upon. And then lastly, if you have access to a Bible, I want you to have it with you. You're going to have a chance to follow along during the message and read the scriptures for yourself. I want to encourage you to do that as well. And now I'd like to invite you to bow with me for our gathering prayer. Holy Spirit, fill our hearts, draw us near to you. Form us and shape us. Open our ears to hear and our hearts to receive all that you have for us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to worship. My name is Jade. I'm one of our worship leaders. Would you continue standing and sing with us?
Every blessing, tune my heart to thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, calls for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of the
My name is Claire Saunders Clough, and I serve as the Care Central Lead Director, Pastor for Resurrection's Care Ministries. As we continue in worship, we now have the opportunity to go to God together in prayer. Prayer is an opportunity to give thanks and even to bless those around us, and that's exactly what we're planning to do today. We want to bless those among us at Resurrection who care for our community, who we call Connection and Care Ministers. These volunteers join us in lifting up all the prayer requests offered, praying for others by name each and every week, and even reaching out to you if care is desired. They remind us of all of us, the work that we're called to do, to be stretcher bearers for one another. So let's bless them today as we go to God together in prayer. Will you join me? Loving and holy God, you are so good. When the darkness closes in, when life seems bleak or mundane, your light fights to shine through into us and into our lives. You are a God not of scarcity, but of abundant life. As we breathe in, let us fill ourselves with your life-giving and awe-inspiring spirit. For those who have forgotten who they are in you, remind them that they are your beloved child. Remind all of us here of your unconditional love. Gracious God, so many of us here carry the guilt of wrongdoing against you. We carry burdens that are heavy, shame that we wish we could hide, and pain that goes deep. For the places where we have hurt you, ourselves or others, we seek your forgiveness. May our hearts be open to the places where you are asking us to change, and grant us the grace to grow more and more like you. As we come to you in this time of silence, we seek your forgiveness for our thoughts and actions that have not been pleasing to you. Hear us now as we silently confess. Lord, thank you for your forgiveness. For those who carry burdens, who are struggling, we pray for strength and for your comfort to surround them. We lift up those who are grieving, those who have lost a loved one, who've lost relationships, for those who have lost their purpose. We pray for those who need strength and courage to take a next step towards healing, a next step towards forgiveness, or a next step towards joy. We pray for those who are searching for a place to belong. Grant peace and strength to those who are caring for a loved one. We thank you for those who are celebrating new life, a new chapter. We pray for those who are seeking a closer relationship with you, who seek you and want to know you more. Lord, wrap your arms around those who have suffered violence. Protect those who have faced harm and pain. We pray for those who are disappointed, who have been let down. We lift those who with courage are trying something new. And gracious and loving God, we join together now in the way that you taught us to pray, asking that it would teach us how to live also. Praying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
My name is Ashley Morgan Kirk, and I'm our online community pastor here at Resurrection. As we continue in worship, I'd like to take a quick moment just to say thank you for joining us. Every time that we gather, we expect that you'll have an encounter with God, and we hope that in response, you might be inspired to get connected to the life of this church and to grow in your faith. As a first step to getting connected, I'd like to invite you to let us know that you're here. You can do that by taking out your smartphone, going to core.org/next, or by scanning the QR code on the screen. Click Tell Us You're Here and register your attendance. Once you've done that, I encourage you to take a look around. core.org/next is our central place for you to find ways that you can get engaged and grow in your faith through this community. I'd love to just take a minute and share some things with you now. Today, we're celebrating and highlighting our care ministries at Resurrection, and I would like to take a moment just to highlight some of those ministries. Our recovery ministry offers support and assistance to those affected by various forms of addiction. We also offer a variety of support groups that meet weekly, and those that are dealing with difficult life challenges. Also, our dedicated prayer team, made up of pastors and lay volunteers, we pray over all of our prayer requests weekly. Prayer requests can be submitted online through core.org/prayer. You can also find that at core.org/next. Our care ministries support our entire Resurrection family. So as a part of our online community, if you're a part of our online community, we care that you have this access and we want to care for you. So we want you to know recovery ministry is available for you. Support groups are available for you, and you can receive prayer and care from our care team. You can find out more about all Resurrection care ministries at core.org/next this weekend. Secondly, for our students who are out there, if you have been thinking about participating in one of our domestic serve trips this summer, you can still sign up and you'll receive 10% off if you register before March 1. So we have a variety of opportunities in places like Little Rock, Arkansas, Asheville, North Carolina, and right here in Kansas City. So for all the dates, all the details to sign up, you can visit core.org/next. And now, as we continue in worship, I'd like to invite you to make an offering. Offering is our worship, and it's a way that we give back to God our thanks and praise. This is how we make mission and ministry happen, both here in Kansas City and abroad. It's all because of our collective generosity. So at this time, I invite you to give and to give generously. To make an offering, you can go to core.org/next and click Give Now. And additionally to giving electronically, you can mail in your offering, and you can do that at the address, which you'll see on the screen shortly. Let us now continue in worship by listening for God's word in this next song.
And grace goes on deeper. darkness, you are near. So draw me close to where you are. And every breath, all that I am, every affection of your heart, you are my hoping, uncertain prayer. You draw me close, ever so close, every assurance of your heart.
As we continue worship, I invite you to hear these words of scripture. Our passage today is Romans chapter 8. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of Scripture.
St. Paul is credited with writing 13 letters, the earliest documents of the New Testament. He penned some of the Bible's most powerful words, and also a few of its most confusing. Paul's letters had a profound impact on Christian theology and faith, and they continue to speak to us today. The significance of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection is revealed to us through the gospel according to Paul.
I want to ask you a question. When you pray to Jesus, if you do, how do you picture him? When you think about Jesus, how do you imagine him? Not just what he looked like, but what he was like. When you think about his character, his heart. If you were describing Jesus to someone else that didn't know him, how would you describe him? Now today, we continue in our series of sermons in Lent, looking at the gospel according to Paul. And we're going to look today at Paul's image of Jesus. How did he picture Jesus? And in the process of doing that, I'm hoping that we'll ourselves be informed. Our picture of Jesus might be shaped by Paul's picture of Jesus. Now, you know, from the very beginning, Christians have wondered, what did Jesus look like? How could they portray him to other people? And the earliest images we have of Jesus that still exist go back to around 235 AD. Dura Europa is a city in Syria. It's an ancient city. And there we found the earliest image we think we have of Jesus. Take a look at this image, and you'll see that there is Jesus healing a man who was a paralytic, and he's picked up his mat to walk. And if you look at it, Jesus doesn't have a beard, and he almost looks like an angel here, but he's a man in a Roman toga. And so this is the earliest image we have. When we think from here, we go to the 500s. There are other images, a few images between then, but in the early 500s, there's an image that became very famous. It was found in St. Catherine's Monastery on Mount Sinai. So some of you have been with me there in Sinai, in the Egyptian peninsula. And there we find this image called Christ the Pantocrator. Take a look. And as you look at it, you'll notice it's an icon, and you'll notice he's holding what appears to be a Bible. It's probably the four Gospels. His hand is upraised in a blessing, sort of a posture of blessing or a position of teaching. And as you look at his face, his eyes, they each look a little different, and it's thought that perhaps the expression in each eye was meant to represent the dual nature of Jesus, that he's both divine and human. Pantocrator means ruler of all and or all-powerful ruler. And so this was how Jesus was pictured. And he was the all-powerful ruler. He was both human and divine. So the image that we have of Jesus, the picture of Jesus, is actually pointing towards deeper truths about Jesus, what people believed about Jesus, what we still believe about Jesus. The last image I want to show you is actually an image in Ravenna in northern Italy. And you'll see here in this image a tile mosaic at the front of the church. And this is Christ the Emperor. So this is at a time when there were still Roman emperors. And you'll see he's holding a gospel open. It's the Gospel of John, and it says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, I want you to notice he doesn't have a beard. He looks a bit different than the last image, but I also want you to notice that he's standing on something. He's standing on a lion, and he's standing on a snake. The serpent in the Garden of Eden represented the tempter. The devil in 1 Peter chapter 5, Peter writes, the devil is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And Jesus is stepping or stomping on both of them. He has conquered both of them. It's a very powerful image of who Jesus is. So I ask you again, how do you picture Jesus? Now, I think back how different people picture Jesus in different ways throughout history. And I think back to a TV show that came on when I was a kid, 1974. And this episode is from the first year of the series. The show was called Good Times. And it was a black family living in the projects in Chicago. And in this particular episode, the mother, Florida, had been talking about this picture she had of Jesus on the wall, and her son JJ, which was famously known, he was famously known for shouting dynamite in almost every episode. He had painted another picture of Jesus. So take a look. It really captures something interesting about how we think of the portrait of Jesus. Take a listen.
Mama, couldn't we at least let Black Jesus hang alongside?
Forget it. The only Jesus I know is him, and the one thing he don't need is a partner.
Mama, how do we know Jesus wasn't Black? He could have been from the lost tribe of Israel. They were supposed to be Black.
I bet they were. If ever people were lost, we're it.
Now just hush up, both of you. This picture has been in my family for as long as I can remember. When I was a baby, I don't know what I saw first, my mama, my papa, or this Jesus. Now, he's the one I know and love, so let's close the subject. Jesus was Black, the Bible would have said so.
But it does say so.
What are you talking about?
I read about it. It's in Revelation chapter 1, verse 14. I read about it in Muhammad Speaks. It says, his hair is like wool, and his eyes are like flame of fire.
Oh, Lord, have mercy. You sure do say that, don't it?
And see, Mama, look at that hair, like wool, ain't it? And look at them eyes, red like fire.
Yeah, they sure is. Jenny, how come you decided to paint this?
I don't know. All of a sudden, I just had divine thoughts on my mind.
And for JJ, that's a first.
What, having divine thoughts?
No, having a mind.
I guess I ought to be grateful for JJ having Jesus on his mind in any color.
Then we can hang him on the wall, Mama?
Well, now, I...
Please, Mama.
All right. But just for Black History Week, after that, he comes down.
So what I love about that clip is it points to the fact that we imagine Jesus like us. And I think that's why the Gospels never tell us what Jesus looked like. They easily could have told us the color of his hair, the color of his eyes, what he, you know, what his appearance was like, but they don't say that. Instead, I think they leave to our imagination, and I think God intended this, to imagine Jesus like us. So Asians might imagine Jesus as an Asian Jesus, Latinos as a Latino Jesus, Native Americans as a Native American Jesus, Pacific Islanders and Blacks and whites, that we see Jesus like us. I want to ask you again, how do you picture Jesus? All right, so when we think about this, I want us to think together about how the Apostle Paul pictured Jesus. Now, Paul never knew Jesus, not in person. So Paul was probably in his early 20s when Jesus walked on the earth, when Jesus was crucified. Paul might have been 23, 24 years old. He was probably living in Tarsus in southeastern Turkey, and came to Jerusalem. He'd studied there, grown up in Jerusalem in many ways, studying under the greatest teachers of the law. He comes back to Jerusalem, perhaps shortly after Jesus dies. There is a fledgling movement of Christians who are preaching the good news that Jesus was the Messiah, but that the Jewish leadership had put him to death. And as they're teaching that, this is embarrassing for the religious leadership. Paul wants to establish himself as a religious leader. He has a great ambition. And so he volunteers to suppress this fledgling movement of Christians. They were actually called followers of the way at the time. And he begins to persecute them. He begins to arrest them. He even presides over the death of one of those Christians, a man named Stephen. And then one day, as Paul is on his journey to Damascus, from Jerusalem, and he has papers allowing him to arrest Christians in Syrian Damascus, he is blinded by a light, a vision that comes to him. Christ speaks to him. He can't see for a couple of days. And Christ speaks in the midst of that vision, "Why are you persecuting me, Paul?" He called him Saul. That was his Hebrew name. "Why are you persecuting me, Saul?" And he says, "It's hard for you to kick against the goads." And then finally he calls him to stop persecuting and to begin preaching Jesus. A couple of days later, his eyes are opened and he's baptized and he becomes a follower of Christ. This is his first experience of Jesus. He never saw what Jesus looked like, not in person. He never heard Jesus' voice in person. He never saw any of the things that Jesus had done in person. He's converted to Christ, and then he goes off for 3 years and he tries to make sense of this experience of Jesus. And in the process of doing that, thinks about Jesus in the light of everything he knew about the law. He was an expert in the law. And in the process, I suspect in prayer and hearing the Holy Spirit and listening for Jesus' voice, as we listen for his voice all the time in our lives, he grows in his understanding of who Jesus is. He eventually goes to Jerusalem. He meets and spends 15 days with Simon Peter. Here's the stories of Jesus that Simon knew from the 3 years of public ministry Jesus spent with Simon and the other disciples. He listens to James, the brother of Jesus, who grew up with Jesus. So he learns a little bit from them. So he picks up the story, and he picks up the rest of the story. I'm sure over the years with other people who are followers of Christ, he comes back to Jerusalem again 14 years later. So he's getting these stories, but most of what Paul knows, his primary impression of Jesus isn't from the Gospels. The Gospels weren't even written yet. Get this. Paul is writing the earliest part of our New Testament. The Gospels are written, most scholars believe, after AD 68, and three of the four after AD 70, maybe all four. Paul dies in AD 65. He doesn't have access to the Gospels. He's listened to Peter for 15 days. He's had conversations with others. He had a personal encounter with Christ. And so Paul's emphasis in his writings is not on the things that Jesus did. You don't read about the miracles of Jesus in the letters of Paul. You don't read about the things that Jesus said. Paul alludes to what he says, and he quotes him a couple of times, but that's it. We don't hear a lot about what happens in the earthly life of Jesus. We hear about Jesus who was crucified, dead and buried, and rose from the grave. The crucifixion of Christ and the resurrection of Christ is what matters most to the Apostle Paul, and that shapes his picture of Jesus. So I want us to think together about what we learn about Paul's portrait of Jesus from Paul's epistles. So I don't want to start with a title that Paul uses of Jesus more than any other title. So this title is Christ. The word Christ means anointed one, someone who had oil poured on their head. And this was a term that was used to describe people who were set aside, or anything, any object in the Hebrew Bible that was set aside for God's purposes. It was anointed with oil. So the objects in the temple, here at Church of the Resurrection, our bishop came when we dedicated this building and anointed the baptismal font that's right below me here. I can still see the oil on it from when he set it apart for God's purposes. The altar table, even the pulpit was anointed. Well, that was true in the Old Testament as well, when the temple was built, and before that, the tabernacle. But also, prophets were sometimes anointed by God, set apart for God's purposes. Priests were sometimes, particularly the high priest, set apart for God's purposes. But most often in the Hebrew Bible or the Old Testament, the person who was set apart and most often referred to as a Messiah, that's the Hebrew word, Mashiach, is the same word as the Greek word Christos. The person who's most often set apart and anointed with oil was the king. So when Paul uses the word Christ about Jesus, he's not referring to Jesus by his last name. He's not Jesus Christ as though it's his last name. It's a royal title. He is the king. He is the one set apart for God's purposes to rule on God's behalf. Now, in the entire New Testament, aside from Paul's letters, we find the term Christ appearing 85 times in the New Revised Standard Version of the New Testament, 85 times. Now, just so you know, Paul's letters comprise 23% of the New Testament. Everything else, another 76%. So in Paul's letters, so the rest of the New Testament, 76%, 85 times the word Christ is used. In Paul's letters, it's 13 letters, 23% of the New Testament, 369 times Paul uses this term to refer to Christ, more than any other term he uses to refer to Jesus. What is that telling us about his portrait of Jesus? His portrait of Jesus is that Jesus is the king. He is the ruler. He is the Christ. He is the one who rules over everything on earth. Now, people can rebel against his rule. People can choose not to follow his rule. And he rules on behalf of God, who is the ruler of the universe, right? People can turn away from him. They may not know that he's the king, but anyone who knows that he's the king and chooses to follow him, they become a Christian, right? You hear the word again. They become a follower of the anointed one. So Jesus is the Christ, and we are Christians. We are followers of the anointed one. We're followers of the king. So this is the royal picture that Paul has of Jesus. The portrait he has is Jesus is the crucified and resurrected king. All right, you hear that in the ways that he talks about Jesus and the terminology for which he uses about himself. So if you turn to Romans chapter 1, as Paul introduces himself to the churches in Rome, he says, Paul, a servant, or actually the Greek word is slave, a slave of Jesus Christ. Like, Jesus is his master. He is the king. He is the ruler. And he has submitted himself entirely to Jesus. Sometimes, so he uses that term in Romans and also in Philippians, but elsewhere in the rest of his epistles, he usually refers to himself as Paul, an apostle of Christ, or an apostle of Christ Jesus. So when he talks about Paul himself as an apostle, the Greek word apostolos means one who is sent. Now, in the book of Philemon, just in this one letter alone, and then nowhere else, he refers to himself as Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus. Now, at this point, Paul is in prison, so he's literally in prison because he's a follower of Christ, because he's a subject of Christ, but he also sees himself as a prisoner to Christ. He's bound to Christ. He can't help himself. This is who he is. He's bound himself to Jesus. He is a captive to Jesus, and so he sought to live his life in obedience to Jesus. I recently saw a clip from the coronation of King Charles from this last May, and in that clip, I had not seen this particular part of the coronation ceremony. I didn't watch it all online when it happened, but in this particular clip, King Charles is there with his 5-pound crown on his head, and he's sitting on the throne, and Prince William comes. So King Charles has just been coronated. Prince William comes, and he kneels before his father and pledges his allegiance to him. This is a picture, I think, of Paul and his relationship to Jesus, who pledged his allegiance to Jesus. Take a look.
I, William, Prince of Wales, pledge my loyalty to you, and faith and truth I will bear unto you, as your liege man of life and limb. So help me God.
Many churches have kneelers, particularly Catholic churches, have kneelers where you kneel in the pew. The reason why you kneel before Christ is because he is Christ the King. We have kneelers at the front of our sanctuary here at the Leawood location. And when we have communion, I invite people to come and kneel. Not very many of you do it, but I invite you to come and kneel before Christ as you receive communion as a way of, again, you know, recognizing he is the King. He is the Christ. We kneel before him. This is why we bow when we pray and we close our eyes. We bow as a position of submission, really, offering ourselves to Christ. And this is why every morning when I wake up, I get down on my knees. He is my King. And I'm offering myself to him. I'm pledging my allegiance to Christ, just as William did to his father, actually in a much more intense way. But William was reading from a card. I, from my heart, say, here I am. You're my King. And I want to follow you. Now, another line, and by the way, this is why we sing so many hymns about Christ the King. So you're familiar with some of them. There's also many praise choruses that are like this, but I think of Come Thou Almighty King, one of my favorite hymns in the hymnal. Rejoice, the Lord is King. Crown him with many crowns, all glory, laud, and honor, and many others. Now, the second title that Paul uses for Jesus, a distant second, 238 times he uses it, is the Greek word kurios, which means Lord. Now, in Latin, the term was dominus. So dominus is the same thing. It means Lord, master, ruler, sovereign. And it could be used of anyone who was in a position of authority in a given realm. And so sometimes if you saw somebody as a higher authority than you, you would call them kurios. It was like addressing someone as sir. In a household, in the patriarchal world, where the husband was the head of the household, the husband was the kurios of his household. The mayor would be the kurios of the city. The king would be the kurios of the kingdom. The emperor was the kurios of the empire. And of course, people saw God as the kurios of the cosmos. And so the term could be used in different ways. And Paul uses this term 238 times with reference to Jesus. It becomes so important that calling Jesus Lord was actually the earliest confession of faith or creed of the church. And so Paul says in Romans 10:9, he writes, if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and in your heart you have faith that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved or delivered. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Again, this was the earliest confession of faith. And Paul often speaks about Jesus in these terms. He calls him Jesus Christ, our Lord. So he's bringing together, there's Jesus. Who is he? He is the Christ. He is the King. And he is our Lord. If you're a Christian, he is our Lord. He is our sovereign, our ruler, our master. These two terms go hand in hand. Jesus Christ, our Lord. In Philippians 2, 10 through 11, Paul describes what he thinks will happen at the end of time, at the climax of history, at the last judgment. And he says this, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend. In heaven and on earth, and even those under the earth in the realm of the dead, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. For Jesus to be Christ and Lord means that we have pledged our loyalty to him. We've pledged our lives to him to seek to follow him. And of course, what Jesus said in his life was those who lose their lives for my sake will find it. We find the only life really worth living. We find joy and peace and all these other things that we've been longing for when we say that Jesus is Lord. Now, there are other things that Paul says about Jesus. 27 times he refers to Jesus as the Son of God. 2 times he refers to him as the image of God. And so the imprint of God in human flesh. And some say that by referring to Jesus as Lord so many times, and that word Lord, kurios in Greek, was the way the Hebrew Bible translated or talked about Yahweh, God. And when it was translated from Hebrew into Greek, they used the word kurios. And so some think that his use of the word Lord is pointing towards the divinity of Christ. In any case, these are the royal titles that Jesus uses, that Paul uses concerning Jesus. But I want to recognize that, you know, in our images of Jesus, we might have this image of Jesus as a ruler, as an authority figure. I want to put back up on the screen Pantocrator, this image of Jesus as the ruler of all the world. And, you know, he doesn't look harsh there. He doesn't look particularly friendly either, but he looks wise and all-knowing. And so, you know, I appreciate that image, but some of us in our minds have an image of Jesus that is a judge who is harsh, who is angry, who is ready to strike us down or push us away. I mean, we have this picture of Jesus as a police officer or somebody who's, you know, making sure that we follow all the rules all the time. And that picture of Jesus might have been contributed to us by our parents. Often the way we look at our dad and how our dad's treated us might leave us with an impression of what Jesus is like. And so some of us have pictures of Jesus that don't look compassionate or kind or caring. When we look at rulers, a ruler, a Christ, a king could be harsh or kind, can be selfless or selfish. And so again, we go a little deeper into Paul and we ask, well, when Paul thought of Jesus as the Christ, as the king, as the Lord, what did he think of him like? What was his character like? So as I think about this, I think about the question that we had here at Church of the Resurrection at the Leawood location when we were constructing the stained glass window. And I remember being in conversation with the artist, Tim Carey and David Judson, who owned the studio. And I said, guys, we have got to get the figure of Jesus in the stained glass window right, because people are going to walk in this room and they are going to see Jesus. And if we get it wrong, if he looks, you know, he can't look too carefree. He needs to look serious. And at the same time, he needs to look warm and welcoming. And if we get it wrong, it's going to ruin the window. And at one point I remember saying, maybe we shouldn't even have the face of Jesus. Maybe we just have a cross of light in the window so we don't get it wrong. And we went back to, well, let's just keep trying. And it's interesting, when I saw the film about the making of the window called Holy Frit, it shows at one point the artist struggling. Narcissus, who is the one of the artists they brought in and an expert in probably the best known person in the field of stained glass, and Tim Carey and then David Judson kind of watching over them, and their struggle with this, getting Jesus right in the image they created for us here in our Leawood sanctuary. I thought you might enjoy seeing a clip from the film Holy Frit. Take a look.
Let's face the real issue. It's all about this gentleman. If you have the head finished successfully, you've done a third of the project.
I just feel squeamish about it. Not in a way that's like I don't have faith, but I still do, but this window could potentially affect tens of thousands of people, so it's a really heavy responsibility.
Every degree of a rotation of a piece of glass turns them from serene, peaceful, welcoming Jesus into scowling.
That's what happens when you do something for the first time. You have to figure it out.
But it takes patience, and that's something that our young artist doesn't have very much of.
I'm at a point where I'm kind of scared.
Why don't you use this, and why don't you pile up a fade? Just pile frit.
I'm having to listen to somebody else tell me how to do a face, which I've never had to do that before.
I was confused based on the fact that I'm seeing stuff here that's not...
I know, but that it's not finished.
Okay.
You're so nervous.
What?
Relax.
I'm just saying.
Cut me that.
Ow! What do you think it's going to be like when we open up the kiln?
I have no clue. None whatsoever.
They actually ended up making two versions of the face of Christ. It's 5 feet tall, the face of Christ in the window. And they made two versions. The first one they weren't happy with, and then they made one more, and they felt like they got it right. The first time I saw it, I'm like, I'm not really sure. And then the more I saw it, the more I thought, okay, I think his eyes, they're right. They show a kindness in his eyes. There's just a gentle, almost a smile on his face. He's serious. You know, he's one who's crucified and buried and resurrected, and yet there's a love there. And you combine that. I love the fact that in his face, there's browns and reds and yellows and all these different colors, you know, of humankind. And then I love the fact that his arms are outstretched, welcoming everyone. This is what it actually looks like in the room if you've not seen it in the room before. And captures this sense, I think, of the welcome and warmth of Christ. But you know, no image that anybody can create, no artist can create, will perfectly line up with either what I have in my mind or with what we find in the scriptures describing what his character was like. In the end, of course, what we're talking about is not what Jesus literally looked like, but what he was like and how we picture him in our minds. So when the Apostle Paul thinks about what Jesus is like and he thinks of him as the Christ, the Lord, how does he picture Jesus? What is his character like? So here's what we find in Paul's letters. We find that Jesus is the one who, as king, laid down his life for his subjects. Paul talks about this again and again and again, that Paul died for us. He freely and willingly gave himself for us, that he showed us this kind of depth of love in his sacrifice, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. We're going to talk more about the meaning of Jesus' death in a couple of weeks, but I want you to see right now this idea that this is a picture of God's love for us and of Christ's love for us. What king freely lays down his life for his subjects? Most of them are in hiding and they have their warriors fighting out front, but not Jesus. He lays down his life for us. Some have suggested that when Paul wrote 1 Corinthians 13, and so he's writing a portrait in words of what love looks like, that what he was really doing was putting down on paper what he saw Jesus as like. Listen to these words again. Love is patient. Picture in place of the word love, Christ. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. This, I think, was Paul's portrait of Jesus. It's how he saw Christ. We read that it was Christ's love that compelled Paul to do what he did. So we read these words, "The love of Christ urges us on because we are convinced that one has died for all." Or in Ephesians chapter 3, Paul's great prayer, which I mentioned last week, he says, "I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God." This week, I received a call that a young woman that I've known since she was born had died. She was only 36 years old. She had a very sweet spirit, and she was a really special young woman. And yet she struggled. And in her struggles, those struggles tied into addictions, and just there was struggle. She'd committed her life to Christ, and yet she struggled. She'd come here to Church of the Resurrection sometimes, but she struggled in her life. And this week she had died. Probably due to an overdose. And when I was sitting with her father asked me, you know, "Do you think I'll see her again in heaven? I want to believe that. I want to believe that Christ was in her heart. And do you think I'll see her again in heaven?" And, you know, this really was about what picture of Jesus do you have in your mind, in your heart? I was thinking, and I shared with him, you know, Jesus, the picture of Jesus we find in the Gospels, which is also a picture we find in different ways, but the same image in Paul's letters. In the Gospels, Jesus is telling us that God is like a father who has two sons, and one of them wanders away and makes a mess of his life. And when the boy comes back, before the boy can even say, "I'm sorry," the father runs out to greet him and wraps his arms around him and welcomes him home. And I said, that is what Jesus is saying. That is what God is like. Or Jesus says, there's a shepherd with 100 sheep and one of them wanders away. He doesn't wait for the lost sheep to get eaten or to finally make its way back home. He goes out to look for the lost sheep and he brings it back and he rejoices. And that is what God is like. And Christ came to love sinners and tax collectors and prostitutes and everybody else. I mean, he's constantly reaching out for the lost people. And I said, that's what God is like. That's what Jesus was like. And that's why I have no doubt that your daughter is with him. I shared with him a little clip that I had planned on sharing with you today from the television series, The Chosen. So I've not watched very many of the episodes. I've watched several of them, including the first episode. And what struck me in the first episode of the first year of this series was the way they portrayed both Mary Magdalene and Jesus. Now, that first episode, you don't find Jesus come on the scene until the very end. It's telling the story of Mary Magdalene primarily and some of the other disciples. But there's Mary Magdalene, and she is known as Lily in the first part of this clip, because, or actually the really almost through the entire episode. Lily, probably a reference to Lilith, who Jews believed was a woman who ended up kind of possessed and doing the wrong things and representing that sort of spirit. And here was Mary Magdalene. It appears that her father had died when she was little, but he would read a scripture verse to her regularly from Isaiah 43, about how God had chosen her, how God, you know, formed her, and that she, you know, that she belonged to God. This is what her father would tell her. And then her father must have died, and she had a hard childhood, and eventually she ends up in this telling of the story as a prostitute, selling her body, and she ends up demon-possessed. And when we think demon-possessed, Luke tells us that she was possessed by 7 demons that Jesus cast out of her. And those demons might have been actual literal spiritual entities. They might have been addictions of various kinds. They might have been various forms of mental illness. But this was Mary Magdalene, and referred to again as Lily. And in the scene that I want to show you, when Jesus finally comes on the scene at the last of the episode, Mary Magdalene is in a bar. And she's been hurt and wounded, and she's struggling with these demons. And she wants relief. And so she asks for a glass of, I don't know, wine, some kind of alcohol. And then Jesus shows up. Take a look.
I said, leave him.
That's not for you.
Don't touch me.
Lily, are you okay?
I have to go. Leave me alone. Leave me alone.
Mary. Mary of Magdala. Says the Lord who created you, and he who formed you. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine.
That is what I pictured Jesus doing for this young woman at her passing, is finally delivering her of all of her demons and making her whole and reminding her of something that had been true all of her life and that she knew somehow deep down inside that God had formed her and Jesus had redeemed her. And she was his. Paul writes these words in Romans 8, some of my favorite words he ever wrote. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things, we're more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, and I would say nor any addiction or struggle that you have can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Paul saw Jesus as the Christ, as his King, and knelt before him as the Lord, as the Master, as the Ruler, as the one he pledged to follow with his life. He saw him as the divine Son of God. He saw him as the image of God. And he saw him as one who represented God's love for us. I want to ask you again, what is your picture of Jesus? Would you pray with me? And I'd like to invite you just to whisper this prayer under your breath, wherever you are. If these words speak for you, speak them after I speak them. Jesus, I join Paul in calling you my Christ. I accept you as my King. I wish to follow you as my Lord. In my heart, I kneel before you. I pledge my allegiance to you. How grateful I am that you are my King. How out of your great love, you gave your life for me. I thank you that when you walked on this earth, you sought out sinners and tax collectors, the addicted and the mentally ill, the demon-possessed. You love lost sheep and bring them back to you. I put my trust in your love, O Christ, my King, and I entrust my life to you. In your holy name, amen. I want to thank you so much for worshiping with us today. And if this message spoke to you and you know somebody else who could benefit from it, I'd like to encourage you just to tell them to go on our website and to join us or just tell them to check it out on our website and core.org or cor.org/worship, and they can join us for worship or to hear the message. I want to invite you to be back next week. So next week, we're going to turn to Paul and what Paul said about the Holy Spirit and the church. And this is really an important theme, and we don't talk about it enough. In fact, I've been feeling like I really want to preach an entire series on the Holy Spirit sometime soon, but that may be 6 months from now. We're going to turn to see Paul, more than anyone else in the New Testament, including Jesus, speaks about the Holy Spirit. And we're going to learn, what is the Holy Spirit? Who is the Holy Spirit? How does the Holy Spirit work in our lives? And what does it mean to be Christ's body, the church? So if you plan to be here next week, invite a friend to join you for worship as we continue through the Lenten season. I also want to encourage you in a couple of ways. If you live in the Kansas City area and you can join us in person at any of our locations, why don't you do that the last few weeks of the season of Lent? We're 2 weeks into Lent, and I'd like to encourage you for the last 4 weeks and for Easter, if you have access to get to one of our locations, why don't you do that as a way of offering something to Christ that's above and beyond, if you physically can. We're happy that you worship with us online or on TV, but if you think you can join us in person, please do that as well. And then I'd like to invite you to consider reading through Paul's letters with us. This last week, we began that, and you can go to core.org/next, and you can download a guide for how you read the letters of Paul. And I'd like to invite you to do it. It doesn't take but about 10 minutes a day, and you're going to finish all the letters of Paul by the time we get to Easter. I'd like to invite you to do that with us as well. So we hope to see you next week, and may God bless you and lead you and guide you as you seek to follow Jesus as your Christ, as the Lord, as the one who loves you more than you could imagine or believe. In his name, amen.
Thank you for joining us in worship today. We truly hope this was a place that you encountered God and are looking for ways that you might consider to get connected to this faith community and grow with us here at Resurrection. I want to remind you of a couple of things. You can take that first step by going to core.org/next and click tell us you're here. That's a way for us to know that you are a part of our community. And just by signing in,
And you'll be surprised how many people don't. So if you haven't signed in, today's your day. Mm. And then also just remember, there are lots of things going on in the life of the church.
Yeah, just to highlight a few things as we conclude our time today. Core.org/next has all these things, but again, just to recognize our care ministries, specifically our recovery ministry and our recovery groups that happen, our support groups, whether that be grief or health, or just a life type of support group that you're looking for, we have those as well. And then our prayer requests. If you didn't have a chance to submit a prayer request, we just encourage you to do that. We would love to lift you up in prayer this week. So again, core.org/next. And then the last announcement, if you are a student in 6th to 12th grade, make sure you register this week for one of our upcoming summer serve trips. Again, there's a discount by March 1st, 10% off. So hopefully you can take advantage of that. And if you're interested in volunteering, we would love to have you this summer.
We're so glad that you joined us in worship, and we'll continue next week in our series of the Gospel of Paul, learning from his 13 letters. And until then, we hope you have a great week, and we'll